Welcome back, and we shall continue with our study of Isaac model. As I stated several times in the last lecture on Isaac model, that this is the perhaps the most important model of statistical mechanics. It serves several purposes. On one side, this is the simplest model of many body interacting system, and at the same time it captures most of the essential features like phase transitions, critical phenomena and many other aspects of many body problem. One thing one should know, remember while doing this, that this Isaac model is not just a model by itself. It goes on to explain lattice gas models, the gas liquid transition. It goes on to explain many aspects of order disorder transition, binary alloys. It goes on to be used in polymers. So Isaac model has these multifarious things. At the core, however, the Isaac model is a very simple thing. It just has nothing but spins, and spins are and so I can consider that this is a spin up and down, and there is the, so the spins essential element is that spins can be either up or down. Second is that this is the nearest neighbor interactions. This is very important, that is nearest neighbor interaction. So these two are essential parts. That means this guy here can interact only with this one and this one. So this nearest neighbor interaction makes it really simple, and one may wonder how such a nearest neighbor interaction can explain so many different things. The reason is that this is interacting with this, but this is also interacting with this. So, the effect of the interaction propagates. Now, and the spins can be up and down, they can also flip between the two states. So, this is called two state Isaac model, and as I told you before, that this is the model which was introduced as by a PhD student Ising in 1925, and he solved it, and then people immediately realized the beauty of this. However, one dimensional Ising model does not have a phase transition, as we discussed in the last thing. There are two cases that we solve for one dimensional Ising model, and one of them is that in the absence 1D Ising model, one is in the absence of the field, in the absence of an external field, the other one we have a field on. Now, the solution in the absence of an external field is very simple. We described it is just if n spin is cos hyperbolic 2j by kbt to the power n. That is a simple solution. In the presence of field, the solution is far more difficult, and but still analytically doable. And the solution, briefly to go through that, the solution of this one dimensional Ising model. So, this is the Hamiltonian of the one dimensional Ising model, that this j is the, you know, the coupling term. And so when sigma I can take, so no, the AI we take, the notation we take, that when it is up, spin is up, we get sigma a value plus 1, when it is down, we get the value minus 1. So, when this and these are nearest neighbor, So, one should realistically have a thing here that is saying that these interactions, of course, I and I plus 1 does that also, the same purpose it does. Usually one writes something like ij here and then put because sum is over both I and j, that is the other notation that one use, otherwise one can also use this notation. Now, if you look at the character of that, so if when the one this I spin and I plus 1 spin, say this is the ith spin and this is the ith spin and this is the I plus 1, when both of them or rather take well this is not the best example, but let us say when both are up, then both of them brings plus 1 plus 1, then these become minus j, and when they are down, then again minus 1 minus 1, then also you get minus j. However, when one is plus and is minus like here, then this will be plus and this is the minus, and this will be plus and this will be minus, and this whole thing then contributes, this particular pair contributes a minus term and then becomes plus. So, when they are parallel, whether they are both up or both down, they contribute negatively to the total Hamiltonian, and that is favorable. So, when two parallel spins are favorable up or down, that is called ferromagnetic interaction. However, when they are opposite spins, so in that ferromagnetic interaction opposite spins are not favored, because this comes with a plus j, contributes positively, increases the total energy of the system. And this one now is the external field and B is the external field, but B actually has in it two terms. One is the external magnetic field H and the magnetic moment mu. So, B is H mu, and this is the way the Hamiltonian reduces to. This is a very simple Hamiltonian, it just takes into account certain favorable interactions and certain unfavorable interactions, and then one attempts to solve this thing and see what kind of result that comes out. So, one dimensional Ising model, as I said repeatedly, can be solved exactly, and if we discussed it next time. So, this is again the Hamiltonian written, all the nearest neighbors and everything. Now, so partition function of these things will be written as the sum over all the configuration. So, when you take the sum or all the, so sigma 1 is plus minus, sigma 2 is plus minus, and sigma n in plus minus. So, you have all in all 2 to the power n configurations. So, the way it is, it is good to draw an analogy with gas that we have done. In a gas, if I take a one snapshot at a given time, then I have the molecules at different locations. So, the molecules at different locations give at a given time a given configuration of the system. So, now the molecules interact with each other, and when the molecules interact with each other, you get an interaction energy, and you are, of course, in this case you have the kinetic energy. In our case in Ising model we do not have the kinetic energy, but we have the potential energy, and we have discussed at length the potential energy is sum over the pairwise additive term. Here you have many nearest neighbors in a three dimensional or two dimensional systems, and you sum up the potential energy of interactions between them. So, a given configuration of a gas or liquid is equivalent to specifying positions of atoms and molecules at given positions, and that in an instant of time that position is changed and the new configuration is created, and your Hamiltonian reflects or captures this change in energy with respect to the change in configuration. So, when the system goes to a configuration which is low energy configuration or favorable configuration, then in the Hamiltonian that is reflected with a low energy or negative energy, which then in the partition function in e to the power minus beta e to the power minus beta h term, which is here e to the power minus beta h term, it has more weight. So all favorable configurations come with a larger weight. Now let us now analyze how that is reflected in Isaac model. In Isaac model with a ferromagnetic interaction where parallel spins are favored, whenever the spins are a domain in spins are parallel, then that comes with a lower energy. So those configurations are picked up. So this is the reason why at a low temperature you get a transition to a ferromagnetic phase. Now one dimension, as I discussed in the last class, does not have a phase transition. It does not have a phase transition, put you bluntly and very straightforwardly, simply because it does not have sufficient number of nearest neighbors. It has just two nearest neighbors in one dimension, and that is not enough to give rise to one. There is a beautiful theorem in this thing that goes, that is I discussed in my book. I will just refer to it a little bit, to the Kolesnikov and Menuhin theorem, which formalizes what I said, that why 1D cannot have a stable ground state or a ferromagnetic state except at temperature T equal to 0. At temperature T equal to 0, 1 over beta is 1 over KBT that diverges, so only this one particular configuration is picked up. So now, so the idea is then is to calculate this partition function, but I would like to tell you that the purpose of this class is different from the last class. I am just preparing little bit, spending some time to talk about it and then go over to what I am going to do in this class. So here I write now the canonical partition function, which is the function of the temperature, total number of spins and the magnetic field B. And that is written in straightforwardly from the Hamiltonian, which is given here. That Hamiltonian is written and gets into this partition function. It is rewritten again essentially for certain periodic boundary condition, which is we do not need to discuss now, but it essentially says that you can make it into a ring, and that is possible only in 1D, this beautiful ring thing. So that these and these spins, so the one next to that is the same configuration, and so make it into ring, that there is an advantage of mathematical representation which allows us to solve this problem. Okay. Now these I discussed little bit that this is solved by making a method called transfer matrices. And I do not want to, this is essentially discussed here, I do not want to go into that detail, that is, but I solved at length in the last class the case when there is no magnetic field B equal to 0. When the B equal to 0, then this Hamiltonian, if this part is not there, it is very simple, then I can show that this will be e to the power minus beta j plus e to the power minus beta j, and then that goes over to the cosh. And then you get cos to the power 2j by kbt to the power n, that partition function. And then one can show that partition function does not have a phase transition, which is similarly, I will just tell you, give the results of the very well known results of I discussed little bit in the last class how you go through a transfer matrix, then how you use a unitary, this M is a symmetric matrix which is nothing but this x and y are beta j and beta b, and the diagonal and off diagonal terms, but you know I do not want to go into too much detail into that today, but I just want to show you the final results of the partition function, which is for the time being for us is okay. So this is the final expression of the partition function of the n spill in the presence of a magnetic field, and if the magnetic field is goes to 0, then one can show that then this term goes to 0 and you can combine the two things, this goes to 1 and you will get e to the power beta j plus e to the power minus beta j to the power n, that is in the apps when b equal to 0. But important thing is that this is already, you can see this is a considerably a difficult and complicated partition function. However, this, even this complicated partition function which was derived by Ising many years ago does not show a phase transition. You can now go and get the standard, this is ln, you get the free energy from the partition function and KBT ln QI, and that quantity becomes just this quantity, this probably is not needed at this point. So you n KBT ln cos, and this term now when you plot in the magnetization, magnetization is nothing but total number of up spins. So magnetization is number of spins that are up, so that can be obtained by amount of spins up minus number of spins down. So it is just sum over the state of the spins, this gives you the magnetization. When you plot the magnetization against beta, beta is 1 over t, 1 over kVt, then you see that when beta is 0, large temperature, large temperature, up spins and down spins are equally favored. So you have then up spins and down spins equally favored, means you have m equal to 0, which is starting here. Now on the other limit, when t goes to 0 absolute temperature, then beta goes to infinity, and then as I told that then the parallel spins are picked up because they have the lower energy. But see the most important thing, the most important thing is that that continuously goes to infinity. So this is a very important result that shows that one dimensional Ising model does not have a phase transition. Again the details are done here, as I said that this magnetic field is sum over sigma I, which is given here sum over sigma I, which can be obtained by taking derivative of, and this we all know that magnetization is derivative of free energy with respect to magnetic field, and these are things we have done many many times, then written like that, then you can do this little algebra. But even in this case the little algebra does is not too little because of the sinh and cos terms that are involved, but this is the final result that one obtained after doing these calculations here. So this is the, in the presence of the magnetic field, in the absence of the magnetic field is much simpler, and you essentially have the same behavior, that means you do not have a phase transition. This situation is completely different in so this is completely different. So the 1D Ising model does not have a phase transition. This is a very significant result, does not exhibit any phase transition. But even then the one dimensional Ising model plays an extremely important role. So even then I will just spent 1 minute on the importance. This is the model which is used to do polymer dynamics. It has been described myself and reverse myself. Many, many models, many, many cases, this even one dimensional Ising model has been used. And one of the most successful theory of dynamics, interact dynamics of interacting system is based on one dimensional Ising model. Okay, so now that one dimensional Ising model we did, and it, we know how to solve it. I worked out in the last class the zero magnetic field, and in the presence of the complete magnetic field is a fairly demanding calculation, and even though it is just one dimension, so I just referred to the book and the transfer matrix method which you can do. So now we have to go to the next next case, which is, so okay, one dimensional Ising model gave us some understanding of the interacting systems and the temperature dependence, so it does not so fast phase transition, but still it is a pretty nice features in many different ways, it is a close from beautiful solution in terms of cos and sinh. Now we want to do, okay, what happens, and that was the question immediately asked after Ising, that what is happening in higher dimensions. and that turned out to be a really highly enjoyable and but very difficult journey for physicists and chemists. So the higher dimensions people, though it was 25, then it took almost 20 years to get the solution in the 2D. So two dimensional case, the two dimensionalizing model, now we have a say square lattice. In three dimensional you can have face centered or voice centered or simple cubic lattice also. Here you can have all different varieties. So in this case, what you have? You have spins in up and down, but you have spin at every lattice side. So these arrows are in a lattice side. So you have now a spin on each lattice side, and the spin can again do the same thing. Spin can again spin and again point up and down. So that part remains the same. So in the Hamiltonian, we write the Hamiltonian. This remains the same. So Hamiltonian remains the same, but we are working on two dimension. So ij again and nearest neighbor. So now in the case of higher dimension, I can say number of neighbors is now denoted by gamma in this class. So here then in my 2D square lattice, I have gamma 4. If I go hexagonal lattice, then I will have a gamma 6. If I have a simple cubic 3 dimensional lattice, then again my gamma number of nearest neighbor is 6. But if I now go to face centered cubic lattice, I will have number of nearest neighbors 12, and body centered cubic lattice, I will have 8. So, okay. So then in this treatment, in this Hamiltonian, the information about the lattice is coming through the nearest neighbor, number of nearest neighbors. So not only that we have spins up and down, we also have the nearest neighbor interaction. So those two basic features of one dimensional IE models carry on to two dimension and three dimension. And it is really now, but the two dimensional things are exceedingly difficult, and it was solved. It took, you know, a large number of people tried to solve the two dimensional problem. It was solved by Lars von Sugger in 1944 by a solution which is considered the perhaps the most difficult calculation or ever done in the history of physics or science, is the Lars von Sugger solution. Then it was, but Lars von Sugger solved it in the absence of the So what did von Sugger solution? It's a very difficult solution, but I'll say the basic features. It exhibits a phase transition. It exhibits a critical point TC below which the system of spins is ferromagnetic, and above which it is not. So there is a beautiful result and a hugely difficult calculation. The von Sugger solution was in the absence of magnetic field. This was with finite magnetic field was done. Another took the force by calculation by C and Young, and he found then the other beautiful thing, that in the presence of a magnetic field, the phase transition becomes first order and it exhibits hysteresis. So the basic things of magnetic phenomena was captured by the two dimensionalizing model. Three dimensionalizing model, nobody has been able to solve three dimensionalizing model. It remains an unsolved problem. people have done huge amount of numerical work, and people verified that much of the features of two dimensionalizing model remain same as three dimensionalizing model, and people have used three dimensionalizing model for experimental systems, and it has been found to be remarkably successful in explaining many, many things of the, but the fact remains that three dimensionalizing model is has not been it has not been possible to solve analytically. Many people have tried, many people I know have tried, and they could not go anywhere. Two dimensionalizing model itself is very difficult, and it's I can talk you of the solution, but and I can tell you of the basic features, which is more or less here, and there are some many things that are relevant to critical phenomena that I want to talk a little bit later today, that how these things go on. Okay, but before do that, this Bonser solution, I want to go a little different path, and I want to do something which is captures the physics of the problem that you are trying to deal with without really doing this amount of work that is required in two dimensional Ising model. And this is an approximate method that has been invented over the years and has been successfully employed. This is called the mean field approach. And the mean field approach is also goes by the many other name. It goes by the name of van der Waals. That was, one can show the van der Waals equation of state that we have studied, that van der Waals is essentially mean field. Then we have done Landau theory at great detail. Then Landau theory also is this a mean field theory. However, what we are going to do today now, do the mean field theory in the context of the Ising model, and we will get the results of the Ising model, of the results which are of what not 100% correct, approximate, but it will capture many of the physics of the two dimensional, three dimensional system. Mean field theory is really bad in two dimension. It becomes more and more accurate as you go to higher and higher dimensions, and there is always a critical dimensionality where mean field theory becomes exact. But in three dimension is bad, but in four dimension it becomes pretty good. So we will now go on develop the mean field approach. The reason we will develop the mean field approach, that it has a beautiful insight and very useful insight that it provides, in addition to giving results which are highly useful. And in our more or less routine applications, is the mean field theory plays a very, very important role. That is like Landau theory, and we actually do not go back to a very formidable Ising model kind of completely interacting system, just like we saw that Mayer's theory breaks down beyond a point. So then what do people do? People of course try to extend it, like people try to solve the three dimensional Ising model exactly and could not do it. But then the alternative approach that appeared is to take on the education for there, but then build a completely different model like the Landau's theory. Then Landau's theory wanted to take correlations into account, it went on to go with something called Ginzburg-Landau theory. So basically one takes a step backward and developed an approximate theory. There, since the really exact path is kind of blocked for you, you can do a simulation something, but you are not going to do any analytical work. So in that case, you take a step backward, build an approximate theory like Landau theory, then go forward and to make that theory far more understandable and far more useful. So we will now to do the, go to the mean field theory and try to describe what is the mean field theory